want to welcome each and every one of you to our service of worship on this day that God has given us, a day that we might rejoice as one, lift up our hearts in song and praise, and remember who is our Creator, our Shepherd, and our Lord. Would like to draw your attention to the announcements which are printed in our bulletin, and begin pointing out that on September 12th, the Sunday after Labor Day, we will resume our pre-COVID schedule with chapel worship at 8:45, Sunday school at 9:45, and sanctuary worship at 11 o'clock. So just remember that on the 12th, that'll be our schedule. And then on October 3rd, I will be starting an inquirers class for anyone interested in becoming members of the church. The details are in the bulletin. That'll last for 3 weeks. And anybody who's interested, it's not a commitment to join, it's an inquirers class. If there are no other announcements, let us worship God. Please stand for our call to worship. Fools say in their hearts, there is no God. The Lord looks down to see if there are any among us who seek after God.
May we seek after God. May we be counted among the company of the righteous.
Deliver us, Lord. Restore the fortunes of your people. In you, O Lord, we find refuge. Let us call upon the name of the Lord. God looks at us to see if we are wise enough to come before God and offer our confession, to receive forgiveness, and to seek to know the healing love of Jesus Christ in our hearts. So let us prove to God our wisdom. Let us set aside our foolish pride. Let us pray together our prayer of confession. God of the heart, we are a fortunate people. We have all we should desire, and yet we yearn for more. In our privilege, we become blind to those less powerful. We are driven by our empty appetites. We grasp at hollow fantasies without concern for the pain we may bring. Forgive us, Lord. Open our eyes to see the true power of your presence and direct us towards lives of humble service in your holy name. Amen. Our assurance of pardon. The love of God is our firm foundation. Through Jesus Christ, we are given new life. This is the glorious news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Jesus Christ is our Lord, our Savior, our Redeemer. Let us remember his name in all that we do. The peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Please be seated. Please join with me in our prayer for illumination. Let us pray together. Living God, help us so to hear your holy word that we may truly understand. That understanding we may believe, and believing we may follow in all faithfulness and obedience, seeking your honor and glory in all that we do, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Our reading today comes to us from the book of 2 Samuel. We continue our sermon series on the stories from the life of King David. Hear these words. In the spring of the year, the time when kings go out to battle, David sent Joab with his officers and all Israel with him. They ravaged the Ammonites and besieged Rabbah. But David remained at Jerusalem. It happened late one afternoon when David rose from his couch and was walking about on the roof of the king's house that he saw from the roof a woman bathing. The woman was very beautiful. David sent someone to inquire about the woman. It was reported, this is Bathsheba, daughter of Eliam, the wife of Uriah the Hittite. So David sent messengers to get her, and she came to him. And he lay with her. Now she was purifying herself after her period. Then she returned to her house. The woman conceived and she sent and told David, I am pregnant. So David sent word to Joab, send me Uriah the Hittite. And Joab sent Uriah to David. When Uriah came to him, David asked, how Joab and the people fared and how the war was going. Then David said to Uriah, go down to your house and wash your feet. Uriah went out of the king's house, and there followed him a present from the king. But Uriah slept at the entrance of the king's house with all the servants of his lord and did not go down to his house. When they told David, Uriah did not go down to his house. David said to Uriah, you've just come from a journey. Why did you not go down to your house? Uriah said to David, the ark and Israel and Judah remain in booths, and my lord Joab and the servants of my lord are camping in the open field. Shall I then go to my house to eat and to drink, and to lie with my wife? as you live and as your soul lives, I will not do such a thing. Then David said to Uriah, remain here today, and tomorrow I will send you back. So Uriah remained in Jerusalem that day. On the next day, David invited him to eat and drink in his presence and made him drunk. And in the evening, Uriah went out to lie on his couch with the servants of his Lord, but he did not go down to his house. In the morning, David wrote a letter to Joab and sent it by the hand of Uriah. In the letter, he wrote, set Uriah in the forefront of the hardest fighting, and then draw back from him so that he may be struck down and die. This is the word of the Lord. Come down, please. Come on, guys.
A little closer. Come on, in a minute. There we go. How's everybody doing? Good. Cal, can you hear me back there? All right. Yeah. I want to just ask some questions today. And, the first one is a simple one. What's a shepherd? A shepherd.
The guy that cares for sheep.
a guy or a girl. Can you have girl shepherds? But yeah. So somebody who takes care of sheep. So what do you think they do as a shepherd?
They watch them.
So you just sit back and watch the sheep. There goes sheep. Hello, sheep. Is that what they do? That's a lot of what they do. But what are some of the other things they might do? What?
Protect them.
Protect them from what, Quinn? Animals, like gophers or maybe little mink kittens. Kittens come along. Animals that could will probably eat them, like wolves or coyotes or bears or dragons. Okay, what? Dragons don't exist. That's because the shepherds did their job really well. So they protect them from wild animals that might hurt them, because the shepherd's job is to watch over the sheep. And if he, you know, goes out with 20 sheep and only brings 10 back, that's not good. He's lost sheep. What is something else? What else does a shepherd do for the sheep?
Sleep.
The shepherd's out there all the time. That's what makes being a shepherd really hard. And did you know there's still shepherds today? And especially out west, they'll take the sheep up into the mountains where they'll graze. And that's something else a shepherd does, is it helps the sheep find food. They move them from pasture to pasture so they don't eat all the grass up in one place. They keep moving them around. And out west, there are people that they'll spend all summer camping along with the sheep, moving them from place to place. So they make sure they have food and water. You know, they know where the streams are, and they protect them. There's something else they do. Sheep aren't real smart. They tend to wander away. So,
bring them back.
Yeah, the shepherd brings them back. Yeah. And sometimes they wander like down into a hole, and the shepherd's got to get them out of the hole. Yeah. So that's the job of a shepherd. You ever want to be a shepherd?
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah, me too.
Be.
What?
Oh,
you just lay down and use a sheep for a pillow. They're real fluffy. Yeah, no, it's not a bad. Dad, you okay with that? Sure. All right. Now, let's switch over to Jesus, because that's what we talk about in church. What was Jesus' job?
Being a shepherd.
No, he wasn't a shepherd. No, what was his job? His job. He was a carpenter. Remember, Jesus was a carpenter. That's how he started out. So, you know, he helped build things out of stone or wood. That's what we, and his father was a carpenter too, a good thing. But you got ahead of me. In the Bible, they call Jesus the good shepherd. Now, he wasn't a shepherd, but why would they call him the good shepherd? Quinn? No, you don't know? I know, it's a tough one. Well, did he watch after sheep?
No.
No, but did he watch after people?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, yeah. Jesus, he watched after people. When they came to him, remember the crowds came and they had no food, and he fed them. He brought them food like a shepherd does for his people. He protects them from evil. When people get sick or were hurt, he would cure them, Jesus. And especially when people get lost, not going the wrong place, but sometimes we do the wrong thing. We say we're lost, and Jesus would bring them back. That's Jesus' job. Jesus is the good shepherd. So we'll see pictures of Jesus holding a shepherd's crook or something. He wasn't really a shepherd, but he took care of his people like a shepherd. All right? Just remember that. Jesus the good shepherd. Say that after me. Jesus the good shepherd. All right, let's pray. Gracious and almighty God, we are thankful for your son Jesus, who came to us, watching over us, protecting us, helping us when we get lost, and nurturing our souls, because he truly is the good shepherd. And all the children of God said, amen. All right. Bye. Miss Barbara's over there.
great novels have great opening lines. With a few well-chosen words, the author establishes the tone for the entirety of the book. The opening lines should tell us what we can expect to come in that book. For example, Herman Melville begins Moby Dick with the simple statement, "Call me Ishmael." And this informs the reader right away that the book is likely to be about this person and that Ishmael may or may not be his real name. And then Jane Austen. Jane Austen penned the delightful opening sentence for Pride and Prejudice, writing, "It is a truth universally acknowledged that a single man in possession of a good fortune must be in want of a wife." George Orwell, in his novel 1984, writes, "It was a bright, cold day in April, and the clocks were striking 13. We know right away that something in that world is wrong. Clocks don't strike 13. Our reading for today from the Old Testament begins with a line that should rank among the great opening lines of literature. In 2 Samuel, we find these words, "In the spring of the year, the time when kings go out to battle, David sent Joab with his officers and all Israel with him. They ravaged the Ammonites and besieged Rabbah. But David remained in Jerusalem. Winter had ended, and like clockwork, the kings led their armies out to do battle against neighboring countries whose land looked ripe for the taking, or who had the nerve to encroach upon land that was not their own. And on this particular spring, David, king of Israel, David sends his officers and his men into battle against their neighbors, the Ammonites. But David, the king, stays home. And like clocks striking 13, we know that something is wrong. Kings lead their armies. They don't stay home. It's like a football coach skipping the away game and telling the offensive coordinator, "You handle it. I'm going fishing." David abdicates his responsibility by remaining in Jerusalem. And because he stayed in Jerusalem, it happened. Yes, the scripture says it happened, and we know what it is. Late one afternoon, David rises from his siesta and takes a stroll on the roof of his palace. From that vantage point, he has an unobstructed view of a woman in another house bathing. And David finds her attractive. And it's then at this point that the storyteller shifts gears, stripping away any non-essentials of his narrative. And what we find in the next part is this concise hammering of verbs, like a sledgehammer driving spikes, like a boxer throwing punches, just bam, bam, bam. Because what we read after David spots this woman, we read, David sends someone to get info on this woman. They report back her name, as well as the name of her father and her husband. Then David sends people to get her, and the woman comes back to him. David lays with her. The woman conceives. She sends a message back to the king informing him, "I am pregnant." There's no romance here. There's no courtship. There are only these cruel verbs. And David sees something. and he decides that he wants it, and he takes it. David, at this point, he's not in need of companionship. He already has multiple wives and consorts. The woman that he saw, her name is Bathsheba. We only hear her name once. She is the daughter of Eliam and the wife of Uriah the Hittite. Uriah happens to be one of David's military officers, one of his best fighters, part of a group known as the 30. Presently, Uriah is not at home because he's at the front with the other soldiers fighting the Ammonites. But David doesn't care. He sees, and he wants, and he takes because he can, and there is no one to stop him. The story of David and Bathsheba is not a story about adultery. Adultery is an act between two consenting adults. It's still wrong because it shatters the covenant of marriage, but the participants are willing. In this story, there's no consent. There is only force. This story shows us the shameless abuse of power and privilege by no one less than the king himself. You may argue, and many have, that the woman, Bathsheba, she should have exerted some control, that she should not have allowed herself to be seen while she was undressed. But she was in what she assumed to be the sanctity of her own home. It's the king who's spying down from his roof. Just the act of David looking down from the heights of his grand palace informs us of the power disparity at play here. Furthermore, what Bathsheba was doing when David ogled her was a ritual cleansing. After her cycle, she had to do this in order to resume worship at the temple. She is doing what she is supposed to do. While the king, on the other hand, is shirking his duties, taking long naps in the afternoon and wandering the palace with nothing to do. Bathsheba, she has done nothing wrong. And secondly, you might argue, and many have, why didn't Bathsheba just say no to David? Because that would have been impossible. She could no more say no to the king than I could stand in front of a speeding train and stop it with my hands. He was king. He had power. She was a woman with little or no power. She was at home while her husband was at war, her husband who was employed by this king. And she's at home alone when the king's men arrive at her door and inform her the king wants to see her. That's not something she can refuse. She has to go. As I said, this is about power and its abuse. Now, when Bathsheba becomes pregnant, David now has a situation that he must contain. He can't let it be known that he has slept with the wife of one of his officers. His action, it's got consequences. He concocts a plan. He has Uriah, the husband of Bathsheba, sent back from the front lines back to Jerusalem. And David brings Uriah to the palace and casually asks him about the war and how the men are doing. And then David dismisses Uriah and tells him that he should go home and wash your feet, because washing one's feet is an old Hebrew idiom for having relations. David's plan is that if Uriah spends time with his wife, then her pregnancy can be explained away, and David will be off the hook. But Uriah doesn't go home. Instead, he stays and sleeps among this king's servants outside the palace. And when David learns of this, he confronts Uriah, and Uriah explains that while his fellow soldiers fight and camp out in the open, that he should not be enjoying the comforts of his home. It wouldn't be right. It wouldn't be fair to them. The irony, of course, is that David himself has been enjoying the comforts of Uriah's home. So the next day, David invites Uriah back to a meal and plies him with alcohol. But still, Uriah does not go back to his home or to his wife. He remains faithful to his men, his country, and even his king. So, having now failed twice to corrupt Uriah, David then composes a letter for his general Joab, who is at the front. And the letter is brief and horrifyingly chilling. The letter instructs Joab to set Uriah at the front of the fiercest fighting and then draw back from him so that he may be struck down and die. David wants Joab to abandon Uriah in the heat of battle and allow him to be killed by the Ammonites. It's really nothing more than a cold-blooded plan to slaughter Uriah. Uriah, one who has been so faithful to David and to Israel, despite his being a foreigner. Remember, his name is Uriah the Hittite. So David hands the sealed letter to Uriah and sends him back to the front, unknowingly in possession of his own death sentence. Joab receives the letter and obeys the command, and Uriah the Hittite is murdered in battle. In this story, David becomes the king that God warned us about. Back before David, and even before Saul, you remember God was recognized as the king of Israel, king of the 12 tribes. But the people went to Samuel the prophet and demanded that they have a human king so that they could be like their neighbors. And God warned Samuel that the people, they wouldn't like a king. Having a king would be a mistake. A king would take their sons for his army. A king would take the best of their fields and give it to his courtiers. A king would take one-tenth of their grain, and so on and so on. And also, God warned, a king will take their daughters to be perfumers and cooks and bakers. The verb the king will take is the same word that we find in our story for today when we are told David sent his men to take Bathsheba from her home. The king, he will take, and David takes. How sad it is to discover that this is David. This is the one who for the past 5 weeks we have lauded in our sermon series as God's anointed, God's as the shepherd king. But here, in this story, we discover that David has gone from being the shepherd king to being a wolf. And this moment will mark the low point in David's life, a point from which he will never recover. As I said, this incident is not about adultery. It is about the abuse of power. It is what happens with someone with power and with privilege is able to convince themselves that they can scratch any itch that they want. In 2006, the Me Too movement was initiated by a woman named Tarana Burke. Burke's idea was that women who are the victims of sexual abuse and violence need to know that they are not alone. When other women around them identify themselves as Me Too, as also being victims, then they are demonstrating their support and lending their strength so that hopefully the victims will then find the courage to step forward and press charges, because the crime against them can only exist in darkness. The Me Too movement gained momentum in 2017 with the numerous and widespread allegations of sexual abuse brought against Harvey Weinstein. As a successful film producer, Weinstein was not unlike a king. He had overseen some of the most successful films to come out of Hollywood, films you've heard of like Good Will Hunting, The English Patient, Pulp Fiction, Shakespeare in Love, The King's Speech, and many more. That was billions of dollars right there that I just read. And as a producer, and a producer of this stature, he had the power to make or break careers. And he used this power over a period of decades to harass and abuse young women. In 2017, over 80 allegations were pending against Weinstein, and eventually he was found guilty and sentenced to 23 years in prison. But Weinstein's certainly not alone in his crimes. There are too many others, men and women, who use their power to prey on those who cannot defend themselves. David's sin lives on in every industry: entertainment, business, sports, politics, everywhere. The story of David is, of course, an extreme. None of us will ever be a monarch. None of us will murder. But still, whoever we are, we should always be cognizant of the power that we do wield, of the privilege that we possess that others may not have. We should always choose to not be a wolf, but to be the shepherd, protecting, nurturing, and guiding those in our orbit. We must do what David failed to do. I wish I could say that David's sin has gone away. It hasn't. And it lives on wherever someone with power takes advantage of someone weaker. But there is hope. David's house continued on with his son Solomon, who became king. And David's house would continue down through the generations until God chose to give our world a savior from this broken house of David. Out of the transgression of David's house came Jesus the Christ. And despite David's failings, out of that goodness has prevailed. Through Jesus, God rewrites the opening lines of our story with hope. King David may not be the shepherd that we want, but let us use his story as a reminder of what sort of shepherd we should be. And let us do so in the name of the one who is the good shepherd. Amen. I invite you to stand now as together we affirm what we believe using the words of the Apostles' Creed. Please stand. Let us confess together. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. Let us now offer ourselves to God in prayer. Let us pray. God of giving, in our hands, our gifts seem paltry, but in your presence, they can bring an abundance of grace to those who are so hungry for hope. In your presence, we can bring healing, community, peace, and joy to struggling communities. Bless us and these gifts that we present to you today. Multiply our hopes and our efforts that your wonders might come into the world around us. Amen. Please be seated. Let us open our hearts to our Lord in prayer. Let us pray. God of grace, your glory flows down through all generations as you are able to name every family in heaven and on earth. And because you know us, and because you know our names, we freely come to you this day in worship and in praise. We come to be reminded of who you have called us to be. We come to seek forgiveness when we have strayed. We come to rejoice in your love. However, when our lives bottom out, your grace continues. When our spirits run dry, you fill us with your joy. When our faith falters, you strengthen us with hope. You are our God, and we offer ourselves to you. Holy One, our hearts are filled with prayers for our world. We need your comfort and presence in this time, especially of natural disasters. We pray for the nation of Israel, for the wildfires, which are now under control, but which burn more than 4,200 acres. We pray for the people in the western part of the U.S. and in Mexico who are struggling to deal with a water shortage on the Colorado River. We pray for the folks of Ethiopia after fatal flooding in their capital. We pray for the people of France after wildfires consumed over 14,000 acres and injured dozens. We pray for the people of Haiti following last week's 7.2 magnitude earthquake. Over 2,000 lives have been lost so far. We pray for the rescue workers who are hampered by the tropical storm flooding the area. And more than anything, we pray for our neighbors just west of us who have suffered flash floods just yesterday. Our hearts break for those who lost loved ones. God of life, we continue to pray for our world as each nation battles the COVID-19 virus and its variants. We pray that vaccines will be available to all, especially those living in countries where poverty is the norm. We long for your peace, O Lord. We long for your peace that passes all understanding. And so we pray as we watch anxiously the news from Afghanistan. We pray as countries take in refugees fleeing that country. And we pray for the countries who are evacuating their diplomats. We pray as countries withdraw their military forces. We pray for the safety and well-being of those unable to escape. Holy God, be with the people of Afghanistan. Finally, O Lord, you are our Redeemer. And your faith, your hope, and your love surround us always. And so we ask that our lives will reflect your love in all that we do. Transform us, God, and make us new. And as we travel through this week, may we do so with the words of Jesus who taught his disciples to pray, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen." May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace, both this day and forevermore. Amen.